Welcome to Nuked Radio. Today is Monday, March 25th, 2013. I'm your host, Christina Consolo, and this is a special broadcast where we will be discussing if radiation levels in our skies could be making frequent flyers such as pilots, flight crews, business travelers, and celebrities sick from increased radiation that they're receiving from the ongoing emissions from the Fukushima plant in Japan. This would not be the first time that celebrities have suffered the effects of nuclear fallout. We're also going to be discussing historic evidence where nuclear tests were conducted and some very well-known people became sick and died from possible radiation-associated illnesses. We will also discuss several well-known cases surrounding the Santa Susana Rocketdyne plant in Simi Valley, California. And finally, what can be done to minimize the exposure on flights. With me today is Leuren Moret, an atmospheric fallout expert and former scientist at two nuclear weapons labs. Recently, I discussed with her the illnesses in several high-profile Hollywood celebrities such as Kim Kardashian, Lil Wayne, Kelly Osbourne, Rihanna, Justin Bieber, Gwyneth Paltrow, Elton John, Brooke Burke, and others who have within either a few days of transcontinental or transoceanic flight become ill with symptoms of possible radiation sickness, some which occurred during the actual flight itself, including seizures. Several Fukushima researchers who have taken Geiger counters with them on flights have recorded not only 5 times over what the Geiger counter company manufacturer had indicated would be normal in flight levels, but alpha and beta particle readings off their masks that they wore during their flights. Also, an aviation body that monitors radiation levels in the air issued a warning on March 16th of 2011. The London Volcanic Ash Advisory Center had issued a nuclear emergency warning covering 10 flight regions. Among them were airspace zones in China, Korea, Russia, and the United States. This warning, which came from the world's focal point for notifying the aviation industry and the International Atomic Energy Agency, warned on the release of radiation from the Fukushima plant and published it as open-ended. Since this warning has been issued, 3 reactors have gone China syndrome, and there was at least 1 fire in a spent fuel pool acknowledged by the NRC, which is even worse than a nuclear meltdown. Nothing at the site to this date has been contained. We are very fortunate to have Leuren Moret back with us today to answer the question, how bad are we being nuked in our skies, and are today's celebrities and airplanes the new canaries in the coal mine? Leuren, welcome back to the program.
Thank you. It's really a pleasure to do this with you, and thank you so much for asking me to be on your program. It's always very, very interesting and very productive to work with you. You're really a marvelous person, Christina, and very courageous.
Thank you very much, Leuren.
You're very welcome, Christina.
I brought up an article today about the surprising dangers of flying through clouds, but this was published a year before the Fukushima disaster. Passengers on planes flying near or through lightning storms could be exposed to harmful levels of radiation from lightning discharges. A study that was conducted to estimate the radiation levels based on satellite and ground observations of X-rays and gamma rays concluded that the amount of radiation within immediate proximity to lightning events could be high enough to be considered a biologically significant level, which they equated to 400 chest X-rays.
Wow, that's serious.
In addition to radiation dangers, frequent flying causes regular disruptions of sensitive pituitary access due to shifting time zones. Melatonin levels can be clearly affected, and there's also the issue of breathing recycled air. Now that we are also flying through fallout, the concern for our health, and especially people who fly frequently, definitely needs to be addressed. And shortly after the Fukushima disaster, I learned that there had been some discussions with the NTSB of suspending all air flights till they got a better handle on what exactly was coming out of Fukushima. However, it was decided not to do this because of the incredible cost and economic impact that that decision would have created.
So what they did was they flew anyway. They contaminated all the planes, all the crews, and all the passengers. Now, what kind of an economic hit was that?
Mm-hmm.
The cost is passed on to citizens rather than corporations.
Loren, I'd like to read some of these six celebrity stories and get your take on them. I'm going to read a couple excerpts. Case number one is Kim Kardashian. She's 32. She recently became ill following 2 weeks of air travel. She's an American socialite and television personality. The article appeared in the Daily Mail and said Kim Kardashian was rushed to the doctors in tears on Tuesday night, fearing she had suffered from a miscarriage. It has been reported the 32-year-old star, who is expecting her first baby with boyfriend Kanye West, is said to have felt ill shortly after arriving back in Los Angeles from Paris and made an emergency trip to the doctor. A source told the New York Post that Kim had started feeling ill on the plane from Paris and called friends as soon as she landed. Doctors attributed her condition to too much exercising. The week prior, she had flown from L.A. to Nigeria for a publicity appearance. First of all, at least with when I was pregnant, I was told to significantly reduce the amount of flying that I was doing for work because of gamma radiation that would expose the fetus to harmful levels.
That's right. So she did a lot of flying. She is, I think, in her second trimester.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been a very, very stressful trip. This is her first pregnancy. And she was probably on overbooked on her schedule with events and meeting people and changing food and things like that. But she also was exposed to radiation, ionizing radiation from Fukushima and also from flying at high altitude. So she lives in Los Angeles, and she would have been heavily exposed to the Fukushima fallout since 3/11, since those reactors blew up. And I would think that probably she's more susceptible. She's weakened from that exposure. And so even small exposures to additional radiation have a very big impact on a person who is already in a weakened state. And all of the celebrities we're going to talk about, all of these high-profile celebrities that everybody knows who they are, they're all in a weakened state, and she's not any different from the symptoms that they've had, except that she's in a more delicate state because she's carrying a baby.
Right.
Yeah, guys, I'm here with the woman of the hour, Kim Kardashian, at the premiere of her first and new movie, Temptation.
Yeah. I hope you guys like it.
Oh, you know, you look fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
You really do.
Thank you.
How far along now?
I tell everyone 6 months just because it makes me feel better for being heavy, but I'm like 5.5 months.
Yeah, well, you're carrying it well.
Thank you.
You really, really are. And you had a little bit of a scare there.
Yeah, a little bit. You know, just I got sick and, you know, just it's hard when a lot is changing in your body and you get sick and you're traveling and so much is going on. It's tough.
So do you have to slow down a little bit now?
A little bit. You know, I'm just, you know, trying to wear flats a little bit more. Not now, but trying to wear flats. And just trying to take it easy on the traveling a little bit. But it was just, you know, it's tough.
Yeah.
It's not easy being pregnant, I have to tell you.
Are you and Kanye reading the baby books and getting prepared?
You know what? I get a little nervous about the baby books because they freak me out. I'm not going to lie. You know, my
sister, everything you read freaks you out.
Everyone sends me these ridiculous, all these things that happen to your body. I read about it ahead of time, and then some of them are coming true, and I'm like, okay, I'm not ready for this.
Ionizing radiation is 10 to 100 million times more damaging to organisms in their developmental stages, this is before birth, than the strongest chemicals like the thalidomide. So when people bring in chemicals, they think it's as strong or has as much an effect as radiation. But radiation is millions of times worse.
I found an article from Duke University and Duke Medicine Radiation Safety Division that related risk to gestational age. And they said early gestation or first trimester, at this point the rate of fetal growth is very rapid and the fetus as an organism is at its most radiation sensitive stage if fetal demise is taken as an endpoint. The incidence of fetal wastage consequential to radiation exposure at this stage is not known since many women were never aware that they were pregnant at the time of the exposure or miscarriage. And the background rate of miscarriage is believed to be high. 25% to 50% of conceptions. It is believed that radiation injury during early gestation is an all or nothing effect. Second trimester, during this period, the overall growth rate of the fetus has slowed. However, the major organ systems are beginning to differentiate. From a standpoint of future development, the fetus is in its most sensitive stage. The incidence of gross congenital malformations and mental retardation are dose-related and appear to have thresholds, i.e. doses below which the incidence above background is not elevated. In the third trimester, they indicated was not as risky. Irradiation during this period may deplete cell populations at very high doses, over 50 rem, but will not result in gross organ malformations.
Well, I'm going to put it another way. That's all true, but there are more subtle details with radiation effects on the embryo in the first 30 days after, in the first 3 to 4 weeks after conception. And in studies on mice, they discovered that pregnant female mice exposed to radiation, even low levels, caused either spontaneous abortion or resorption of the embryo by the body in 80% of these embryos. If it's female embryos, more of those survived and fewer of the male embryos survived. That's because the XX chromosome of the female is stronger because they're both, the two X's are the same, they're similar. And in the male, the XY chromosome is a weaker bond or it's a weaker conformation. So more of the male embryos die, and that results in an expanding female population and a shrinking male population. Now, that has been studied and observed and quite a bit of research on it published in fish populations in the Columbia River contaminated by the Hanford Nuclear Engineering Lab, the Columbia Rivers in Washington and Oregon. And also in the otters, the freshwater otters living in the Columbia River, the males have smaller baculums. The baculums are becoming reduced in size, and that is the penis bone. Otters and walruses have a penis bone that allows them to mate. And also, they seem to be confused and don't know how to mate. That's some of the subtle differences that happen just from low-level exposure in the first 30 days. Now, if the embryo survives and the exposures in the first 30 days, the eyes, the brain, and the neural tube, which the forms the spine and then the limbs develop from that, I mentioned that before, that can be damaged. And so children will be born with deformed eyes or no eyes or just one eye. It's very complicated. And but they can survive. Now, if the embryo survives and there's exposure in the first trimester, this is when the limbs form and the digits, the fingers and toes develop, and it causes malformation of those. If the embryo or the developing fetus survives the first trimester, in the second trimester is when organogenesis occurs. That's the formation of the organs. And that that's also a very delicate time. But you can have malformation of internally of the organs and so forth. And then in the third trimester, the damage from radiation exposure mostly affects the brain and reduces the ability of the brain to function properly. Now, basically, if the embryo survives and the fetus makes it through the first trimester, and it's been exposed, but it survives, it's going to be a monster. And those are the horrific babies born in Iraq that people have seen so many pictures of. That's the result of internal exposure or fetal and embryo exposure to ionizing radiation. So it's irrefutable. This has been known since the 20s. They can't, these governments and phony experts are declaring that there's no immediate danger and everything is fine. Well, it's not fine.
In looking back through Kim Kardashian's recent flight history and the illness reports that she had recently, I went back a little bit further and found that she had also flown recently to Miami to accept a key to the city. Then she flew to New York to go to a TV premiere. She's had different engagements around the country. If this was a relative of yours and you knew that they were pregnant and flying this much on top of all the fallout that it's in our atmosphere, I mean, how concerned would you be about this baby that she's carrying?
I probably would never talk to her again. It's a question of accumulation, the cumulative effects of whatever her parents were exposed to during bomb testing. They have genetic damage and they carry radiation in their bodies. This is passed on. The genetic defects or mutations, if they're in the sperm or the egg of the mother and father, that's passed on to the children, which would be Kim. So she's carrying the history of her parents' radiation exposure in her body and in her genes. Now, she has been exposed as a young child and into the adult stage to a lot of nuclear pollution from the nuclear power plants in America to the Chernobyl in 1986, which contaminated the entire world, to the depleted uranium and battlefield nukes that they've been using since 1990, the first Iraq War. And she lives in Los Angeles. I have the graph of the depleted uranium levels in the LA drinking water. So she's got that exposure that she's carrying. And these are all cumulative effects. She's flying back and forth to different countries all over the U.S. in through a contaminated air column. And not only that, flight crews and airline passengers are exposed to higher levels of radiation because the atmosphere is thinner where they're flying. And now we've had Fukushima, and it's still coming over. The radiation is still coming over to the United States and going on to Europe, and it just keeps going around the world, which she's being further exposed to. And it's crazy because the drinking water that she's consuming and dairy products, I see her all the time eating frozen yogurt that's full of radiation. And it's a double, triple, quadruple jeopardy. She should not be doing this. She's not taking care of herself properly to ensure a healthy baby.
I wanted to read something briefly about bioaccumulation.
Yes.
To help people understand why people who study radiation are so concerned about this. Bioaccumulation increases the concentration of many contaminants as one moves up the food chain. Beef is much higher in dioxins than cattle feed, and tuna fish have much higher mercury than their marine environment. Radioactive iodine, cesium, and strontium, all beta emitters, become concentrated in the food chain because of bioaccumulation. At the top of the food chain, of course, are humans, including fetuses and human breast milk. In 1963, 1 week after an atmospheric nuclear bomb test in Russia, our scientists observed the magnifying power of bioaccumulation when they detected radioactive iodine in the thyroids of mammals in North America, even though they could not detect smaller amounts in the air or on vegetation. There was a ready uptake in their thyroids.
That's right, because the iodine is in a gaseous phase, and it's invisible. You can't taste it. You can't see it. And it's completely everywhere in the atmosphere. It's hard to even believe that this disaster has happened, but it's not just one disaster. It's the cumulative effects of many. And it's depopulation with nuclear pollution. Dr. John Goffman said that himself.
This article goes on to say, bioaccumulation is one reason why it is dishonest to equate the danger to humans living 5,000 miles away from Japan with the minute concentrations measured in our air. If we tried, we would now likely be able to measure radioactive iodine, cesium, and strontium bioaccumulating in human embryos in this country. Pregnant women, are you okay with that? Hermann Müller, another Nobel Prize winner, is one of many scientists who would not have been okay with that. In a 1964 study, Radiation and Heredity, Mueller spelled out the genetic damage of ionizing radiation on humans. He predicted the gradual reduction of the survival of the human species as exposure to radioactivity steadily increased. Indeed, sperm counts, sperm viability, and fertility rates worldwide have been dropping for decades. And this article was published in the Salt Lake Tribune by Brian Monch, April 10th of 2011.
Well, he's absolutely correct, and poor Kim Kardashian and Kate Middleton, the wife of Prince William, they're both carrying babies. They got pregnant about the same time. All of the food they're eating, the fish they're eating, the oysters they're eating, the milk they're drinking, the ice cream and dairy products they're consuming, it's all very contaminated. And just to give you an example of bioaccumulation, for instance, in oysters, they can bioaccumulate up to 150,000 times higher than the concentration of the radiation in the water they're living in. We also, a small group of scientists that I work with, we collected over 6,000 baby teeth from children living in the U.S., and I went to Japan and collected them, and they went to England and collected them. The radiation levels in we were collecting in the 2000s, they're higher in children's baby teeth than during atmospheric testing. So, it's coming out of the nuclear power plants, And now we have Fukushima and the battlefield nukes and the depleted uranium used on the battlefields in Iraq and Afghanistan and Lebanon and Israel. The Israeli men have the highest drop in sperm count in the world. And in less than 10 years, most men in Israel will be sterile. The also during the, I wanted to make sure that people understand, radiation respects no borders, it respects no socioeconomic class, and it respects no religion. And when they were doing horrific, horrific amounts of radioactive weapons, especially between 2002 and about 2007 in the Middle East and Afghanistan, the British and U.S. were using them. Two prime ministers, well, I should say Gordon Brown, who was the prime minister then, his first baby at the age of 50 was born in about 2004, and she died when she was 10 days old. He had, his wife had another pregnancy a couple of years later, and that one was born with a terminal illness. David Cameron's wife got pregnant at the about the same time that Gordon Brown's wife had the first baby, and that baby that Cameron and his wife had was a boy, and it he was never able to, he was so deformed, he could never do anything but move his eyes. And he died when he was about 7 or 8 years old, maybe he was 10. So out of four pregnancies, because Cameron's wife had another one and it was normal, but out of four pregnancies in that time period, three of the babies had terminal illnesses. You see, these women are at risk. They should not be traveling and flying. They should not be eating food products out of the ocean. They should minimize dairy food intake, and they should be drinking filtered water through the reverse osmosis method. And otherwise, they are putting their babies at tremendous risk. And I'm sure they have no idea.
The second case is Dwayne Michael Carter Jr., known by his stage name as Lil Wayne, who's 30. He is an American hip-hop recording artist from New Orleans, Louisiana. In October of 2012, it was reported on TMZ that he was doing better after an in-flight medical scare on Thursday afternoon that had forced the rapper to make an emergency landing in Texas after he had suffered seizure-like symptoms on a private jet. The craft landed in an undisclosed location in Texas. From there, he was taken to a local hospital and treated for several hours before being released around 6 p.m. local time. His rep had no comment about the incident, and as of press time, further information was not released. Within 24 hours, he had another seizure on another flight. TMZ had said he was on a flight from Texas when he was diverted after suffering another seizure on board to Los Angeles. He was then taken to the hospital. At mid-afternoon, he was still being treated in a Louisiana hospital, but was expected to be released Friday afternoon. They attributed it to dehydration and migraines. In November, it was reported that he had been banned from flying for the foreseeable future by his physicians. But just recently, within the last 2 weeks, he was rushed to Cedars-Sinai Medical Center in Los Angeles after collapsing while filming a music video for Nicki Minaj called High School. He was released on Wednesday, but according to TMZ, just hours later, one of his bodyguards found him in his room on the floor and unconscious. He was rushed to the hospital again. This time he did not stabilize. He was taken to ICU, where he was placed in restraints because he was shaking uncontrollably. He was then put in an induced coma in intensive care, where his condition continued to be unstable. The cause of the seizures was unclear. And MTV actually interviewed a neurologist who was not treating him, but commented on the cause of seizures, and this neurologist stated some people have unrecognized structural abnormalities in their brain or a prior history of trauma that is enough to create an electrical disturbance. But I'd probably say if you were his age and you were coming into my office with your first seizure, in half those people you won't find a reason. Barring a family history, the neurologist said there are also some other non-specific irritants that can produce seizures. And one of those non-specific irritants, according to the Atomic Archive, is radiation exposure. Is that correct?
That's correct. And he fits into what I have been able to discover through very extensive research since the Fukushima disaster in March of 2011. And that is that there's been a very large increase in death rates in the United States as a result of Fukushima exposure. In other words, the Centers for Disease Control, they collect, it's a government agency, and they collect vital statistics, health data from every county in the United States every week. And that is compiled in their archives and data files. It's also posted on the internet. But it's just piles of numbers, and most people would not be able to make sense out of it. But what those numbers say, and this is our own government collecting this information and not releasing it to the public, is that 100,000 Americans had died by Christmas of 2011, less than 9 months after Fukushima, unexplained reason or cause. And when I looked at the large increase in death rates, the highest increase was in the mountain region, which is the west slope of the Rocky Mountains, and it was 10%, a 10% increase in death rates. But when I looked at the state of Texas, this is what gave me the clue. And I looked at the age groups that had the highest increase in death rates. It was not the elderly people. It was the youngest people. It was teenagers in the, like, 18 to 30 age group. And young teenagers and young adults. And I went, oh, my God, there are so many military bases in Texas. The soldiers who came back from Iraq and Afghanistan loaded with fission products from the mini nukes that the U.S. has been using since 1990 in Iraq and later in Afghanistan. These are launched from howitzers, and which is a very large, it's like a cannon that shoots big caliber projectiles. And the mini nukes are in those projectiles. And when I looked at the largest increase in deaths, an 18% increase for that age group in Texas, I said it's got to be the soldiers coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan, and they end up staying. They have to get out of the military because they're dying, but they stay near the bases they came back to so they can get medical care. And so what's happened is, We're seeing all these young people, celebrities, with these radiation-related illnesses, damage to the endocrine system, it's because they were exposed in utero to nuclear bomb tests, which ended in 1963, but there was still radiation in the environment, and also their parents had altered DNA. Because the parents' bodies were contaminated with radiation, and the DNA in the sperm and the eggs were very often altered. Then they turned on the nuclear power program, and that further exposed unborn children, the reproductive tissues of adults or young adults. And so that was the second big assault on the bodies of Americans. And every single person in the United States was exposed internally to ionizing radiation from the nuclear bomb test. And with the nuclear power plants, the highest rates of breast cancer in the United States were 2/3 of all the breast cancer deaths in the U.S. occurred in certain counties, and I've given you a map of that. We crunched the numbers, the Radiation and Public Health Project, a small group of scientists independently did this, and made this map of breast cancer rates, mortality rates in the United States, and it correlates exactly and precisely with the locations within 100 miles of reactors, and that is the nuclear bomb factories like Los Alamos Nuclear Weapons Lab in New Mexico, Livermore Nuclear Weapons Lab in the U.S., and the Idaho Nuclear Engineering Lab in Idaho, and that's, by the way, where the Stuxnet virus was written that triggered Fukushima. And that was written by the CIA and a team from Germany from the Siemens Electronics Corporation. They make the controllers in nuclear power plants and other power plants. And in the 1990s, even before that, depleted uranium was introduced to military arsenals, and all of our military bases, bombing ranges, and gunnery ranges are all contaminated. Now, little, what's his name? William? No,
Little Wayne.
Little Wayne is from New Orleans. All that depleted uranium and the fission products from Iraq and Afghanistan all come across the Atlantic in these hurricanes that originate in the Sahara Desert in North Africa, and they're loaded with depleted uranium and fission products, and the heaviest rain out of that radioactive material is along the Gulf Coast states. So Little Wayne, his parents would have been exposed to nuclear bomb tests. He would have been exposed to, after he was born, to nuclear power plant fission products that contaminate food and water and dairy products in Louisiana. They have big ones there, big nuclear power plants. And then he would have been exposed to all the DU and fission products coming across in hurricanes and being rained out along the Louisiana Gulf Coast. So this poor guy and people living on the West Coast, too. We have nuclear power plants here, like Kim Kardashian was absolutely exposed to those, Diablo Canyon and San Onofre. And so these poor young people who should be healthy are the first to go down because just an additional very small exposure wipes them out.
I want to run through a quick list of what radiation exposure can do to the body. In terms of hair, the losing of hair quickly and in clumps occurs with radiation exposure at 200 rems or higher. The brain, since brain cells do not reproduce, they won't be damaged directly unless the exposure is 5,000 rems or greater. Like the heart, radiation kills nerve cells and small blood vessels and can cause seizures and immediate death. The thyroid, certain body parts are more specifically affected by exposure to different types of radiation sources. The thyroid gland is susceptible to radioactive iodine. In sufficient amounts, radioactive iodine can destroy all or part of the thyroid. By taking potassium iodide, one can reduce the effects. The blood system. When a person is exposed to around 100 rems, the blood's lymphocyte cell count will be reduced, leaving the victim more susceptible to infection. This is often referred to as a mild radiation sickness. Early symptoms of radiation sickness mimic those of the flu and may go unnoticed unless blood count is done. According to data from Hiroshima and Nagasaki, shows that symptoms may persist for up to 10 years and may also have an increased long-term risk for leukemia and lymphoma. The heart. Intense exposure to radioactive material at 1,000 to 5,000 rems would do immediate damage to small blood vessels and probably cause heart failure and death directly. The gastrointestinal tract. Radiation damage to the intestinal tract lining will cause nausea, bloody vomiting, and diarrhea. This occurs when the victim's exposure is 200 rems or more. The radiation will begin to destroy the cells in the body that divide rapidly. These include blood, GI tract, reproductive and hair cells, and harms their DNA and RNA of surviving cells. And then, of course, the reproductive tract. Because reproductive tract cells divide rapidly, these areas of the body can be damaged at REM levels as low as 200. Long-term, some radiation sickness victims will become sterile. Fukushima researchers have been bringing Geiger counters on planes and finding five times over what would be considered normal.
Right.
So how many REMs are they being exposed to?
I have no idea. It's very difficult to convert from REMs to sieverts to, back and forth. They've made all these different units so to confuse people. And each person is very different in how they respond to radiation, and it also depends on the timing, and it also depends on the particular radionuclides. And what they're not mentioning is that there are over 1,900 fission products that are produced in a fission event. Fukushima is different. There was a total meltdown in at least one of the reactors, but what the real problem was the burning of the spent fuel rods, which are pure fission products. Well, there's some uranium in them, too. This is an unprecedented event, so we need to look at the results to figure out what the exposure was or what really happened. This is unprecedented. Fukushima, the Fukushima disaster, and the global exposure of the entire biosphere has never happened before to this extent. And Fukushima was 300 Chernobyls at least. So it's a very, very, very critical, very high exposure to the whole global population. And of course, weather and geography determine where the highest rain out and snow out of these fission products occurs. But it's pretty hard to get away from it because they've poisoned all the oceans too. All the food supply, the water, everything. Now, what I did want to say, let's go back to the airport and flying, and I didn't think of mentioning this, but all of those entertainers, that celebrities you've been talking about, you mentioned, also fly a lot. They travel an intensely heavy schedule. They have a hard time keeping their marriages together because they move around so much. Now, the airports have these backscatter X-ray machines. Those are called soft X-rays. And what Marion Falk taught me, he is one of the last living Manhattan Project scientists, and he's the one who made the hydrogen bomb work for the U.S. government. He's very, very high level in weapons development, but he won't ever even talk about it anymore since Fukushima. He's more of a microbiologist now. And he said those backscatter X-ray machines, backscatter X-rays are about the most damaging X-rays you can be exposed to. And all of these people, Kim Kardashian going through those things, going through those x-ray machines multiple times carrying a baby is a very crazy thing to do. I don't think they have any idea what they're being exposed to. I know they don't, because most people don't realize it. And I was on the phone one day with Marion Folk. He said, who in the hell is making those backscatter x-ray machines in the airports? And I said, well, I think it's, I think that Chertoff, Michael Chertoff, who was the Secretary of Homeland Security, I think he owns one of the companies that manufactures them. He said, absolutely not. Absolutely not. It has to be an old company that's been in this business for many, many, many decades. So I did a search, and boom, the first thing that popped up was Philips Electronics in Eindhoven, the Netherlands. And I did further research and discovered, of course, most of the royal families in countries in Europe own the electronics companies. So Queen Beatrix of the Netherlands owns Philips Electronics. It would be secret, it would be hidden, but that is very likely. And then I discovered that the original design and concept for airport x-ray machines came from England. So there we have the Anglo-Dutch monarchies in a conspiracy to further degrade the health of the public through more exposure to ionizing radiation. And I call the Anglo-Dutch monarchies, these two queens, Queen Beatrix of the Netherlands and Queen Elizabeth of England, the gangsters in tiaras, because those two women and their husbands are behind the whole eugenics depopulation effort, the scheme to depopulate the world, the global population, indiscriminately. And I'm just going to keep bringing it up because people have to realize that depopulation and using ionizing radiation is absolutely a conspiracy that's being carried out worldwide.
Leuren, you appeared on several episodes of Jesse Ventura's show, Conspiracy Theory, about some of these topics we're discussing.
Yes.
Including the x-ray scanners in the airport?
Yes, I did an interview with him on the world's water supply. And then I was invited to do another interview. It was January 2012. Anyway, it was 2012. That's right. And it didn't come on, and it didn't come on, and it didn't come on TV on the Jesse Ventura show. And I finally found out because I called the producers, and they said, oh, the network wouldn't let us show it. And what Jesse talked about, he wanted me to discuss the danger of these x-ray machines because he refuses to go through them. He has a titanium hip replacement. And every time he goes into an airport or through a scanner, it sets off the alarm. And they were so rude to him and so abusive and harassed him so much that he refuses to fly now. And they said to me, the crew said, well, Leuren, we're giving you 5 minutes in this segment. Nobody else gets that much, but we want you to give us a big bang at the end of the interview. And so we were at the end of the interview after we talked about the scanners and everything. And I turned to Jesse because I wanted this to be the end of the program. And I said, Jesse, you were a Navy SEAL, weren't you? And he said, yes. And then I said, you were in Vietnam, weren't you? You're a vet. He said, yes. He's looking straight ahead. He didn't know what I was going to hit him with. And I said, well, then you know about the Phoenix program, don't you? And he said, yes. And I said, well, Jesse, Homeland Security is the Phoenix program.
And what is the Phoenix program?
The whole crew went deadly silent for a whole minute. And Jesse finally said, oh, I never thought of that. And that was the end. The Phoenix program in Vietnam was set up by the U.S. military. And it was set up to destroy the civilian support of the Viet Cong resistance in Vietnam. The Viet Cong resistance was the guerrilla fighters who were trying to push the U.S., get rid of the U.S. in Vietnam. And they, of course, relied on the civilian population to supply them with food and arms and whatever they needed, shelter, clothes, whatever, money. And U.S. military wanted to destroy that civilian support. So they set up death camps and torture chambers and all kinds of horrific harassment of the civilian population, terrible things. That's Homeland Security. And Homeland Security was set up basically it had a lot to do with Oliver North and the FEMA, the Federal Emergency Military Agency, and the Phoenix program. Oliver North was involved in that. So a lot of things that are being rolled out in the U.S. now actually were tested and tried in Vietnam. Another program was Project Popeye, which was the very beginnings of the weather modification, which is now on testosterone and a big part of the HAARP weapon of mass destruction system. So here we are, a whole country, over 300 million Americans, and our lives are going through a paper shredder. Our children are being destroyed with weaponized food, weaponized water, everything. They're closing schools all over the United States now on this austerity excuse. And the U.S. is still one of the richest nations in the world. We are being broken down so they can take us down and just loot this country and destroy the whole population. So what happened in Iraq and Afghanistan at some level is going to happen here. It's already starting.
I actually have quite a few more examples of recent celebrities who had seizures and other things. Kelly Osbourne, case number 3. She's 28. She's an English fashion designer, singer, actress, and is best known for being the daughter of Ozzy and Sharon Osbourne. Kelly, while filming her E! Show, Fashion Police, was taken to a Los Angeles-based hospital where she was expected to stay overnight. She actually stayed 2 weeks. While she was recording the episode, she turned to another star and said that she didn't feel well before she fell out of her chair shaking. An audience member that happened to be a doctor reportedly fled to her aid. She came around a few minutes after the seizure, but her team wanted her to go to the hospital for tests. There was no cause found for any of these seizures. And prior to that, in June of 2012, she suffered from what was described in the Huffington Post as an emotional breakdown on a flight. Sources said that by the end of a flight, Osbourne had looked completely disheveled and was basically carried down the corridor to the airport tram. They surmised something must have triggered a reaction from her during a 4-hour flight, because she had even tweeted photos of herself looking very pulled together at the beginning of it, which was a far cry from how she looked when she left the plane. And again, this is a pretty young girl. She's 28, having unexplained seizures.
These people are all under 30. These are just exactly what I was talking about. These are the young people who've had multiple radiation exposures, and they're more weakened and compromised than older adults. It's the cumulative effect. In the illnesses caused in our soldiers and veterans from exposure to depleted uranium and fission products in Iraq and Afghanistan, similar symptoms and illnesses have been reported, and the number one disease, the number one complaint diagnosed by the Veterans Administration in our soldiers and veterans from these radioactive wars is neuromuscular damage. And polio was invented as a cover-up for the neuromuscular damage caused worldwide by nuclear bomb tests. Medical doctor in Canada, Dr. Levan, was studying the damage to the Canadian population from the huge nuclear bomb tests that the Soviets did in the Arctic. And one of them was such a huge release of radiation that it exposed every person in the Northern Hemisphere to the equivalent of a chest X-ray. And Dr. Levan was looking at illnesses and infant mortality, things like that, where the big clouds of radiation came down through central Canada, through Alberta. And if you read that paper, you realize that polio is the cover story. It's it's an invented disease to cover up and hide the neuromuscular damage that was caused globally by the nuclear bomb tests. So I'm not surprised these are happening. It sounds like they may have mitochondrial damage as well. Mitochondria are little things in the cell that produce all the energy for the body. And I've seen Iraqi soldiers on panels at conferences that I've been at where they would start talking. They were all very, very, very sick. It was so sad. It was just almost unbearable to see these young lives that were already finished. And I remember one young woman who'd been in Iraq as a soldier, and she in the middle of her talk, she would talk for maybe 5 minutes, and then she would just sit there because the mitochondria were not working properly in her brain, releasing energy to propel the signals that go down the nerves. And they have to stop at these gas stations. They're called the syntaxes. And it's where that smoke signal made out of calcium goes down the nerve, and it stops at the syntax and picks up energy so that it can go on to the next one. These are like gas stations along a freeway. She just had to sit there until the mitochondria, even though they were compromised, they were producing some energy, but not enough, fast enough, so it interrupted her talk. And we're just going to see more and more of these kinds of symptoms and strange diseases and things that should not be happening to especially people as young as the people you're talking about tonight.
is.